Excuse me.
Yes?
I'm trying to find the Turboman doll.
Me too, me too.
Do you have any more in the back? What? What's she laughing at? What did I say?
These guys are looking for a Turboman?
A Turboman doll, yes.
They're looking for Turboman.
So funny.
Where have you guys been? Turbo Man's only the hottest selling Christmas toy ever. But you know what? We got plenty of Turbo Man's faithful saber-tooth partner Booster.
Where's your Christmas spirit? That's better. There must be a Turbo Man around here somewhere.
The last one just left. Some lady had it on layaway.
A lady? What lady?
Short, with a fur coat.
Fur coat.
Uh-huh.
Sorry, buddy. Oh!
Give me this.
Hey!
This is war. Poor baby.
Ha! Hey, lady! Hey, hold it! Wait! Wait, lady! I need the Turbo Man!
Boy, that's brutal. I mean, that's like Black Friday at Target or any given day in San Francisco. One of the two. Hey, join me in Matthew chapter 2. Matthew 2. Let me ask you this. What is your Turbo Man? You know, what is it in your life that you're like, I must have that or I can't be happy? That's what makes me joyful. That's what I got to get or I will not be joy. I will not happy. Ain't nothing happening for me. I'm out. I got to have it. Yeah, what are you spending your time on? What are you chasing after? What are you willing to take out a mailman and an old lady for? You know? Now, the way you answer that is pretty telling, because the way you answer that, you just revealed your God, by the way. Because the thing is, God calls us to be joyful. We're supposed to be joyful. Joy is a gift of the Holy Spirit. It is a result of God working in us. Therefore, it is God's grace at work in us. Joy is God's will for our life. I mean, it's what we're supposed to be doing, walking in joy. Now, there are times, let's be honest, when it's really easy to be joyful. I mean, things are going good. You had a David and Goliath moment. You know, you socked the giant. He's down. God has worked. God has moved. Things are good. You're driving down the road, the worship song is on, it's your Jesus jam, you are going, it's worshipful, it's joyful. Those times are easy to rejoice. We all have them. We've rejoiced. But let me ask you this, what about now? What about right now? Because again, if we're going to keep being honest, we're going to find out there are times in our lives where life just is not joyful. Not even a little, because life is hard. Life gets boring. Life gets routine. It gets mundane. It gets painful. It gets slow. And we wonder, God, is this ever going to get any better? And we wonder, where are you in this thing, God? Are you still here? Are you still with me? Because we want more from life. We were created, as the Westminster Shorter Catechism tells us, we were created to know God and enjoy Him forever. That's the thing, man. We want that joy. We want more. We're created for it. But sometimes it's not there. And what's frustrating as a Christian is it used to be. You know, the joy was there and we were rejoicing. And now we look around and it's gone. And the question sneaks in there. Can it come back? Can it come back? Now, in Matthew 2, we get this beautiful account of Oriental astronomers coming to find Jesus, right? They're looking, they've seen his star, and they equated that with Numbers prophecy and Daniel's prophecy that the star would arise out of Jacob, that there would be a Messiah, a king of the Jews born. And so they load up, long story we're not getting into, but they load up and they come chasing him down. And they follow the star and they get here and the star is gone for some reason. And they're in Jerusalem, so like, well, let's go check out the king. Let's see what he's doing. So they go in to find King Herod sitting there, and they walk in. Here's Herod. Here's his court. All Israel's looking, and they go, where's the one born king of the Jews? We came to worship him. And so there's this whole conversation that happens in there about who's the king, where's the king, what's the prophecy, all this stuff. And then they walk back outside after they find out where they need to go. And they walk back outside, this group of magi from the east. They walk back out and you get to verse 9. It says, after listening to the king, they went on their way. Behold, the star they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest of the place where the child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced with an exceeding great joy. In other words, boy, they were chest bumping. They were raising their hands. They were jamming. They were doing everything because they got excited. Why? They saw the star again. Church, when the star, when we lose sight of what God is doing, it can get dark. It can get confusing. And we lack the joy of Christmas. We lack the joy of God in our life. We lack what he's doing. And the question comes, what do you do next? What do you do next? Do you fake it? Hey, we got joy. Yeah, I got the joy down in my heart and stuff like that. Or do we move on and say, well, that Jesus stuff didn't work for me? Because isn't it awesome how we blame God when our lives are bad, but we don't serve God when they're good? But it's what we do. But so we move on to the next thing and we try to seek something else. The answer is no. The answer is we stop. We look back, we recenter ourselves in the will and the mind of God, and we find joy again there, just like they did. We find joy again in looking again at God's promise to us. And what is that promise? God is with us. Emmanuel. Christmas means God keeps his promise. Christmas means joy is possible. Christmas means what God is doing at work in you is something big, because here's the thing about God. When God makes a promise, God starts it. And when God starts it, God finishes it. How do we tap back into that? Well, today we want to get our joy back. We want to look into this thing, and maybe you're joyful, but you want to grow deeper in joy. Maybe you've fallen off the joy wagon somewhere. Whatever that case may be, let's see how to get back. Before we dive into that, though, I got to address two things really quick right up front. Well, three things. Number one, my name's Joey. I'm your pastor. No, I've been gone a couple weeks, but I'm back. Number two, there is a difference between joy and happiness. We need to understand that, okay? Happiness is more circumstantial. Happiness is something that happens to you and there's a response to it. I mean, happiness is when somebody offers you a cookie and a cup of coffee. That's happiness. Happiness is when they get your order right at Sonic. That's happiness. You know, that's where you're like, yes, no cheese on the burger. You ever tried to order a hamburger from a fast food restaurant without cheese? They do not accept that. That's happiness. It's something that sparks in you. Joy is so much different. Joy comes from within. Joy is a fruit of the Holy Spirit. Joy comes from God. Joy is comfort and peace. And yes, there is an overall sense of happiness that you actually, little things make you happy. When you are joyful already, it's like throwing wood in an already burning fire. It just makes it bigger, but it comes from within, and it is not based on your circumstances. It is not based on what's happening to you. There is a joy within. That's the joy that God gives to us. The second thing we need to understand about joy is, like most things, joy is not a destination. It's a journey. Joy is something that occurs to us in our life daily. It's not like, boy, I've arrived at joy. I may now say, no. It's a continuous thing. We're growing. In fact, it's a cycle. Joy is a cycle. And here's how it works. It's a cycle that lets us see. Because as we see God at work, we get more joyful. And as we get more joyful, we see God at work more. And as we see God at work more, we get more joyful. And as we get more joyful, guess what happens? We see God at work more. And when we see God at work, I could do this all day. You see the cycle.
as we follow, as we rejoice, as we follow, as we rejoice, God is at work, and we experience a joy that is full, a joy that sees. That's the kind of joy God wants to give to us. But like I said, it is a cycle, guys. It's something that we work at. So whether you've fallen off the joy cycle, whether you're somewhere on the joy cycle, whether you've never entered the joy cycle, today let's see how this thing works and see how God begins to move in our lives, even in those times when we feel joyless, how he brings the joy back. And we find that it is a joy that sees our God. So today we're going to look at the story of the Magi here. We're going to see four movements on the joy cycle that let us see God at work. Four movements in the joy cycle that let us see God at work. And as we follow these guys, we're going to get a joy that sees. We're going to see his promise. We're going to see his purpose. We're going to see his power. We're going to see his glory. We're going to see who he is. And it's going to change everything from the inside out in us, because we will have that joy that sees. But we got to follow these movements. And they build on each other, okay? Because it's a cycle. They build on each other. So let's dive into the cycle. Number one, first movement, joy starts with pursuing Jesus. Joy starts with pursuing Jesus. This entire text is about the Magi chasing Jesus. They're chasing after him. Look in verse 1. Okay, back to verse 1 here. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who's been born king of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose, and we've come to worship him." But when Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. Stop there for a second. This is where we begin. They pursued Jesus. They saw the star, and they said, "Whoa, that's pointing us somewhere. We got to go." And so they began to pursue Jesus Christ. Let me ask you this. In your life right now, are you pursuing Jesus? Are you chasing after Jesus? You say, "Joey, what does that even mean? I mean, it's a church thing, pursue Jesus." How do we do that? Do we chase down a car with a bumper sticker of the fish on? I mean, what do we do? Pursuing Jesus is something that we mean by actually looking at Christ. I'll give you four ways to pursue Jesus here. Number one, know him. You got to get to know him. See how, and know him, not your version of him. Look and see what is revealed about Jesus. Study Jesus. Look at what he does, who he is, how the prophecies unfold about Jesus. Get to know Jesus. Secondly, to pursue Jesus, we began to look for Jesus. Look for him. Don't just read him and know him historically. Know him actively. He is working. What do I mean by that? You look in the world around you, we get discouraged, we get dismayed. We think Turbo Man's what we need. Look for how Jesus is working. Look for where he is. You see a broken marriage. Where is Jesus in this? How does Jesus want to heal? You see a broken human. Don't discard them. Look and say, "Okay, Jesus is in this because he's in this to redeem. Let me go find it." And you start looking for him wherever it may be. The circumstance in my life right now that is hard, that is stealing my joy. Where is Jesus? Begin to look. But next, imitate Jesus. Imitate him. The way you see him love, you love. The way you see him speak, you speak. The things he values, you value. And lastly, abandon yourself. You cannot pursue Jesus and pursue your own self-interest at the same time. Can't do it. You know, because what we do is we chase after our own stuff. When I say you abandon yourself, I'm talking about your desires, your will. Gone. Why? Because his is better. It's John the Baptizer saying, "I must decrease, he must increase." It's Jesus himself to the Father saying, "Not as I will, but as you will." That's our pursuit of Jesus. We know him, we look for him, we imitate him, we abandon self. But boy, we get into some wrong pursuits, don't we? We pursue things that are not joyful, but we think they are. We chase after money, because money makes the world go round, right? We need it. Do we? Are we ever satisfied there? Is there ever any joy? What about our stuff? I mean, yeah, we need stuff, okay? Don't misunderstand me. I'm glad all of you wore clothes to church today, right? I mean, that's a valued thing. We're glad you did it. But is joy really in what you wear? What about our fame? What about our reputation? What about our relationships? Boy, don't we need all that stuff to be happy? Listen, there are all these wrong pursuits that we have. They're not always that we're pursuing something evil. You know, like I said, I'm glad you wore clothes today, and I'm glad you had money to buy those clothes, right? But the thing is this, all of these things are wrong pursuits, are distractions. That's what they are. They're just distractions. You know, I'm wearing a llama sweater today. How many of you like my llama sweater? Yeah, I mean, he's got a little thing here. He's got glasses. On the backside is a backside, but, you know, whatever. And this shirt is really loud. Yeah, I mean, I can't go around airports wearing this. But it's this, like, thing, and I'm looking at this sweater today, and I'm like, I probably shouldn't wear this because I don't want to distract people from the sermon. I mean, this is a pretty distracting shirt. But then I also thought today is ugly Christmas sweater day at church. So I have to wear an ugly Christmas sweater, but this could be distracting. I mean, this became a real dilemma for me. Distractions that you chase, thinking you are going to find joy, are going to do nothing but rob you and drain your battery. You're going to think you're making progress because you're almost there, and there's joy in a pursuit, but when you get it, what happens? You find it's not. And you gave so much of your life pursuing something that you shouldn't pursue. The Magi didn't get distracted. They're looking for the king, and they're standing before a dude sitting on a throne. And they go, where's the real king? They're not distracted by the temple building. Depending on when you date Herod's death at 4 BC, 1 BC, whichever way you lean on that. But you look at this, the temple could have been building right here, the new temple they're building that Jesus and the disciples talk about later on. About 10 to 15 years worth of building done to this temple. They are not walking into Jerusalem going, oh, he's the king, we made a mistake. Oh, look at how great this thing's going to look one day. They're after Jesus. They're after Jesus. And you say, well, Joey, I do pursue Jesus. I'm at church. Let me ask you this. Are you pursuing Jesus or are you pursuing a church culture? Are you pursuing Jesus or are you pursuing some degree of morality? Are you pursuing Jesus or are you pursuing satisfaction and fulfillment from ministry? Because those are all different things. When the wise men came to Jesus, he hasn't done anything yet. He's not healed anybody. He hasn't preached a sermon. He hasn't done a miracle. He hadn't raised anybody from the dead. Has never yet given anybody a fish sandwich. He hadn't even eaten one yet. Babies don't do much. But they sought him for who he is. They came to him for who he is. How arrogant are we when we think the almighty creator of the universe cannot satisfy our longings? That we need something outside of him. Church, we have got to become obsessed with Jesus. Because where you start this pursuit of joy, your starting point is going to mark your life. And it's going to put you on a direction. May that direction be the pursuit of Jesus, because that's where joy starts. If you're pursuing all these wrong pursuits and wrong joys and going out, you're like a cat chasing a laser pointer. It's fun to do that to a cat. But it's not a way you want to live your life. Joy starts with pursuing Jesus. But it doesn't stop there. Second movement, joy grows from God's promises. Joy grows from God's promises. I love this part. Go to verse 4. Assembling all the chief priests, scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for so it's written by the prophet, and you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people. All right, catch something here. The Magi had been pursuing Jesus, but they hit a snag. They didn't see the star anymore. God had led them to this point with what we call natural revelation, right? But now we got to get more specific. Now the word of God has got to get involved. You don't get to just chase your opinion of Jesus. You've got to chase the revealed Jesus, right? Now we get the word of God involved. And they find out, oh, he's in Bethlehem. And then in a minute, they're going to walk out and see the star going toward Bethlehem. They see the star again. They see it going to Bethlehem. They get the promise of God met with the direction, and they're going, yes! You ever had a moment like that? Where you look at God's promise, and you say, yes, I know what God's up to. That's joy. Joy reflects back on the promise, and Christmas represents the promise of God fulfilled. These people had been 400 years at this point with no word from God, 400 years in bondage, 400 years in darkness, 400 years craving, God, are you still there? But they had a promise that on this night was fulfilled. What promises are you holding on to? What promises have you let go of because you didn't think they were ever coming? You know, this is how we rest in God's promise. This is how we do this. Number one, remind yourself of God's promise. Remind yourself. There are going to be times when your sin is going to steal your joy. But I want to remind you of the promise that God forgives. And he said, if you will confess your sin, I am faithful and just to forgive it. There are going to be times you are weak. I want to promise you and remind you of God's promise that his joy is your strength, that he provides strength for the weak. You might be sitting here going, yeah, Joey, I've lost people, but he has promised he will never leave or forsake you. You may be sitting here going, yeah, Joey, I don't know what to do. I am lost in this darkness. He has promised you he will provide wisdom and guidance. These are his promises. Are you resting in those? Remind yourself of those. Next, rest in them. Rest in them. Say, God's got this. I may not feel like he's forgiven me, but he said he would. Therefore, he did. I may not understand still what I'm supposed to do, but God said he'd direct me, so he does. This is how you rest. Then you respond to the promise. After you've reminded yourself, rested in the promise, now respond to it and go, I'm going to do what God tells me to do anyways. Why? Because he said he is with me. He's got this taken care of. I'm on the way. That's how this works. And what this does for you, it leads you to see God's hand in everything. It builds your faith. And the more convinced you become of God's word and God's promise, faith and hope, the more joy you'll have. Because things won't shake you. The big question I want to ask you right now is, how much Bible do you have in you? How much promise do you know? And with that promise that you know, how much promise are you resting in? What are we doing with what we know? Because Christmas, more than anything else, means that God's promises never fail. And he promised in Jeremiah 31, verse 13, he says, because of what he does. And by the way, this is in the context of the same passage that will be quoted later in Matthew about all the women losing their babies and crying out and refusing to be comforted for her children because they are no more. Same context. He says, then shall the young women rejoice in the dance. The young men and the old will be merry. Why? Because I will turn their mourning into joy. I will comfort them and give them gladness for their sorrow. When we understand God's promise, we understand his intention. And we get to hold that. We get to hold it. Because what God promises, God begins. And what God begins, God completes. We hold it. And he's always at work in redemption, restoration, and reflection of his glory. That brings joy. That lets us see what God's doing. But we're not done. That's only movement two. The third movement in the joy cycle is joy matures through obedience. You guys see a trajectory here? It starts with pursuing Jesus, grows from God's promises, matures through obedience. We're not done yet. Here is the joy that sees. We get the word. They've given the word. We've got the word. But now we must go. We've got to be obedient. Listen to this in verse 7, okay? Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word too, that I too may come and worship him. Spoiler, he doesn't want to worship Jesus. But he's lying to them. He's saying, yeah, go, yeah, come back. And now verse 9. Listening to the king, they went on their way, and behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. Listen to the joy. Look at all these responses here to the word of God. All right, listen to all these responses. Number one, Herod. Herod's response. They walk up to the dude who's sitting on the throne and they go, where's the real king? Herod was an Edomite. He wasn't even a Jew. So this news of a Jewish-born king, whoa, that's a legitimate claim to the throne. Somebody the Jews would rally behind. Herod was going to have none of it. Herod's thing was this. He says, I am the only king there will be. How many of us do that in our own lives? I'm my king. I will do what I want. I will pursue what I want to pursue. I'm going to be. Herod was a guy who murdered his favorite wife and four of his sons at least because he felt they were threats to his throne. This is the guy. What are you doing so that Jesus cannot sit on the throne of your heart? Where are you chasing? What are you pursuing? I love King David. David sinned as well. He decided he was going to be a king. All the people were out in the war. David let them go. And then David is up on the roof one day. He sees a lady taking a bath and he says, joy. And he goes and fetches her, brings her to himself, sins with Bathsheba. And we get some pretty good psalms out of that. You get penitent psalms out of that, where David cries out to God, broken. My soul's getting old within me. It's waxing. My bones are falling apart. God, I feel so guilty. And then he cries out in Psalm 51, having pursued a joy outside of God, he cries out in Psalm 51, don't remove your Holy Spirit from me, but rather restore to me the joy of your salvation. He began to understand joy's not over there. Joy is in you. Give it back, God. Don't be a Herod. You also get the people of Israel here. The people of Israel heard and they saw what all was going on and they were scared to death. Their reaction was fear. They just hunkered down and did nothing because they were scared of what Herod was going to do. Many Christians are doing that today. We're hunkered down in fear and not doing what we know God has called us to do. Then you get the scribes. The scribes knew the word. It does not say, I did not read to you at any point today where the scribes had to go and convene and have a meeting and get out their Logos software and Google and try to figure out where this prophecy was. They knew it. They said, oh, he's born in Bethlehem of Judea, like the prophet Micah says. I mean, that's where he's going to be born. In fact, his goings forth have been from of old, from everlasting. He's eternal God. Man, we knew it. Sanhedrin 99, written in the Jewish commentaries on the Torah, said all prophecies prophesy only of Messiah. They understood this. But yet they didn't get up and go the 5 miles from Jerusalem to Bethlehem to even check it out. Their response was laziness. Oh, but the Magi. The Magi step out. The Magi are going, okay, Bethlehem, check. Let's go. And so they get out here and they look and then they see the star. I want to purport to us that many, many times we've lost our joy is not necessarily because of something we have done, it's because of things we are not doing. Jesus told us in John 15, he says, and listen to this, as the Father's loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I've kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Why is he telling us all this? Why is he talking about keeping the commandments, abiding in my love, showing my love? Because of verse 11, these things I've spoken to you. Why? That my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. And the commandment in question, he says, this is the commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Anybody ever been in love? I'm still in love. I have a wife, kids, stuff like that. You know, I have you guys. Man, I missed you guys last couple weeks. You know, I mean, here's the truth, okay? I mean, I say this and I lie not. I would tell Jesus this. In fact, I did tell Jesus this. Not being with you guys was worse than not tasting coffee. You know, I missed you guys. But you know how when you're in love, everything they do is just a joy? I mean, you joyfully give, man. You rejoice to see them succeed. You rejoice to watch what they're doing. Now imagine if we loved as Jesus loves and we were obedient to the command, love one another. The joy that would come from us preferring one above another. You know, you above me. And the joy that would come from us sowing into and investing in each other so that we grow in Jesus, that type of a joy through obedience to his teachings, that's a joy that begins to see God move. And when our joy starts with pursuing Jesus, grows from God's promises, matures through obedience, then we get the fourth movement. Joy results in lifestyle worship. Joy results in lifestyle worship. Listen to verse 11. Going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother. Then they fell down and they worshiped him. The response of joy is worship. I told you earlier that how you begin this pursuit is going to mark your life. If you find your joy in Jesus and you find who he is, worship is natural. And worship gives. Listen to what worship does. It says they gave him, opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Gold. That's a pretty nice gift. Frankincense and incense, worthy of prayer. An expensive ointment, an expensive perfume, all kinds of stuff. Myrrh is also quite expensive. Myrrh is a healing agent. Myrrh is a disinfectant. I mean, it's like a really expensive can of Lysol. It's also an embalming spice, you know, signifying his death. What they're showing here is Jesus is prophet, priest, and king. They're bringing gifts worthy of a God. Why? Because he is God. You see, when you begin to find your joy in him alone and your life is marked by that joy, his value increases in your eyes. Therefore, the stuff we value begins to decrease, begins to fade. And we bring him these things, and the joy factor grows. We see in this pursuit and his promises and our obedience, our joy and our satisfaction in him gets greater. And you know what begins to happen? You begin to live in joy. You begin to serve joyfully. You begin to share what you have joyfully. You begin to share his gospel joyfully. You sing joyfully, even if it is without talent. It's still joyful. Why? Because that joy motivates. That joy makes it a lifestyle. And I love how they were warned by Herod, by God, not to return to Herod. Let me get that right, or I'll commit heresy. Thank you. They understood, the angel warned them, or they got warned in a dream somehow, don't go back. But they also understood Herod doesn't get this. Herod thinks his life is there. Herod thinks his joy is there. He doesn't get this. You're going to have friends who don't get why you give so joyfully. You're going to have friends who don't get why you love people who hate you. They're not going to understand how you can serve joyfully someone who is of a different political party than you. They're not going to understand that. But we do, because we found what matters. And it's a joy that sees. A joy that sees what? A joy that sees a purpose bigger than ourselves. A joy that sees and experiences God's faithfulness. A joy that grows in the promise and seeing what God does. A joy that taps in to God's purpose, God's promise, God's power, God's glory, and a faith that begins to connect with real life in real tangible ways. And it results in a joy that continues to see. Question is, who are you in this story? We're talking about finding our place in the Christmas story. Who are you in the Christmas story? Are you Herod? My way. Are you the people of Israel? I'm just going to see how this plays out. Are you the scribes who know but do not do? Or are you the Magi who pursued him, who rejoiced in the promise, who became obedient to go and see, and who joyfully gave of their treasure in worship? Who are you? Guys, I get it's hard to be joyful when things are hard. I get that, I know. But what we learn from this and from the Christmas story is that we focus on our Savior, not our situation. We refresh ourselves in the Word of God. We obey what we know even when it's hard. And we find joy in the little things, knowing that even the little things we are obedient in have eternal impact all around because of his greatness. Is it possible? I want to read this account from a third century man who was about to be martyred. And this is what he wrote to a friend in his last words. He said, "It's a bad world, an incredibly bad world. But I've discovered in the midst of it a quiet and holy people who've learned a great secret. They found a joy which is 1,000 times better than any pleasure of our sinful life. They're despised and they're persecuted, but they don't care. They're masters of their souls. They've overcome the world. These people are the Christians, and I'm one of them." That's the joy. Maybe you've fallen off that joy cycle somewhere, and now's the day to get back on. How do you start pursuing Jesus? Maybe you've been on this joy cycle, there's joy in your life, I want to tell you it enriches, it keeps going. Or maybe you've been sitting here today and you realize you've never experienced that joy. Then I want you to come find me before you leave today, because I can share with you what Jesus Christ has done and help you to see that joy that sees. Now you may be thinking, Joey, that's a dude from the third century, man. I mean, yeah, of course he found joy. They were all holy back then. They didn't have the problems we have today. I want you to listen to this testimony from one of our own who's experienced some pretty dark things, but also learned to find the joy of Christ through it.
Hi, I'm Tori, and I normally go to the 9 a.m. service. Today, I have the pleasure of sharing joy with you. The biblical definition of joy says that joy is a feeling of good pleasure and happiness that is dependent on who Jesus is rather than who we are or what is happening around us. Joy comes from the Holy Spirit abiding in God's presence and from His hope in His Word. And joy is a state of being and not circumstantial. So you can always find joy in anything you're going through, because if you have Jesus, you can find joy. A part of my testimony is in 2019, I got diagnosed with cancer. Through ups and downs and lots of treatment, I am now in remission, but through the whole process and current, still today, I can still find joy through the little things, even when things are frustrating or hard or a side effect of radiation or is complicated, you can still find joy because I know that Jesus holds me and He is the ultimate healer. And I also want to encourage you to find joy in your circumstances, because it might not be something big in your eyes, but you can connect with someone else and you can share your testimony and share Jesus's love with the joy you have by, say, getting a bad grade on a test but still walking out smiling. Someone can ask you why, and you can share why you can still be happy because you have joy in your heart that comes from Jesus, and that can start a whole new conversation. Thank you for letting me share joy with you today, and I challenge you to find joy in all the little things. With Jesus in you, you'll be surprised by how much joy you can find.